Everybody that's outside, if I can have you start to pull into the sanctuary. We can pull everybody from the outside into the sanctuary. And with that said, good morning, Southgate. Oh, man. Something's going to happen today. There's some fire coming from out in those pews. Maybe it's because we have, well, I know one of those voices I heard was Brother Barlow. Everybody say good morning to him. We so happy to have you here. You have no idea. We miss them amens. And uh-oh, come on now.
So there's lots of chatter going on. It feels...
Yes.
It's different in here this morning.
Yes, hallelujah. So we're going to read from, I know I usually do Psalms. I'm going to do Deuteronomy chapter 26 and starting in verse 1. It says, "And it shall be when you come into the land which the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance, you and you possess it and dwell in it, that you shall take some of the first of all the produce of the ground which you shall bring from your land that the Lord your God is giving you, and put it in a basket and go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to make his name abide. And you shall go to the one who is priest in those days and say to him, I declare today to the Lord your God that I have come to the country which the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket out of your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall answer and say before the Lord your God, my father was a Syrian about to perish, and he went down to Egypt and dwelt there, few in number, and there he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. The kingdom of God is growing and growing and growing, and you're a part of it. And there's a church around the corner and a church up around the street. When you worship this morning, we are not alone. We are not backing up. We are not slowing down. We are growing across the world. Look in Africa. Look all the way around the world. The kingdom of God is growing. People are being healed. People are being resurrected from the dead. When you worship this morning, worship knowing that you have power. You have the power of God, and you have entered into that rest. You've entered into his presence. No, we're not in heaven yet, but we are seated in heavenly places. In Jesus' name, amen.
You can stand with us this morning. Let's worship the King this morning.
Shadows cover me. When I'm walking through the valley, I won't fear my enemies. 'Cause everywhere I go, you surround me. And every step you go before, even through the pain, you remind me that every victory is yours. I know I'll be saved. I know I'll be safe with you. I know I'll be safe. I know I'll be safe with you. 'Cause you are my strongest defender. Nothing can stand against you. I know I'll be safe. I know I'll be safe with you. If you call me on the water, I won't hesitate at all. 'Cause even if I stumble, you will catch me when I fall. 'Cause everywhere I go, you surround me. And every step you go before, and even through the pain, you remind me that every victory is yours. I know I'll be safe. I know I'll be safe with you. I know I'll be safe with you. 'Cause you are my strongest defender. Nothing can stand against you. I know I'll be safe. weapon formed, no raging storm could overwhelm you. No politics, no government could overthrow you.
Amen.
No weapon formed, no raging storm could overwhelm you. No politics, no government could overthrow you. No weapon formed, no raging storm could overwhelm you. No politics, no government could overthrow you. Sing that again. No weapon formed, no raging storm could overwhelm you. No politics, no government could overthrow you. I know I'll be safe. I know I'll be safe.
Break every stronghold, Jesus in the street, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
Father God, we thank you this morning, Lord God, that we can speak your name and things change in the instant, Father God, that healings take place, Father God, that families are changed, Lord God. Father God, that our enemies come to know you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being in this place of worship this morning, Father God, and meeting us here, Lord. Lord Jesus, we pray over this morning. We pray over Pastor Bill as he speaks this morning. Father God, let no one leave here without being totally changed, Lord God, in some way. We thank you, Lord God, and we give you all the praise, all of the honor, and all of our glory. In your name, amen. You guys may be seated. Turn around and say hi to somebody. We haven't done that in a while. I missed that. Hello, everyone. Yeah. It's so awesome to see all of you here this morning. I want to give you a quick announcement. It's pretty big. So if you know our youth, for years and years, we have raised money for Speed the Light. And Speed the Light, the money goes towards us getting able to buy vehicles for missionaries. We help with Convoy of Hope, who shows up at all the times that people need things. We've actually gone and helped with Convoy of Hope. It was a lot of fun, awesome experience for our kids. So my leader, Joe Ward, look, he's right there, Joe. And is Charles here today? And Charles defaults. They came up with a plan. They're like, hey, we want to raise more money for Speed the Light. So let's do what we like to do best. We love to cook. We love to grill. We love to smoke in our smokers. So, yes. If husbands need to know how to do that, go talk to these two. They are awesome grillers. So on June 26th, we are having a fundraiser right after church, and it's kind of a cook-off, but it's going to be an epic cook-off. So let me go ahead and let you watch this video for a second.
I will tell you this, and I've said this before and I'll say it again. I think Charles is going to burn the pork butts. Well, I will tell you, if I was Charles, I would probably buy one of my tickets for a brisket, because he's going to need to pack a lunch. It's going to be an all-day buffet. Beef is what's for dinner. And some baked beans and potato chips.
Joe, I'll tell you right now, you better watch it. Bring your Bible. It's gonna be a long story after this. Bob will tell you like this. This is how it's gonna go down. I'm gonna use good wood. I'm gonna use pulled pork on top of mac and cheese. It's going down. It's gonna be the best. This Indiana boy's gonna show you how it's done.
Don't they do like chicken, like portabit? That's the only thing I saw in Indiana.
I heard you take your finger and rub it in between your toes before you meet your meat up.
Yeah, that's how you get that nice black crust around the brisket.
That's burnt.
It's not burnt, it's seasoned.
No, seasoned like, brown, not
no,
black.
You want a nice char on the brisket.
You got white ends from the ash on it.
It's called a bark, Charles. And here's what I'm afraid. I'm afraid your bark is bigger than your bite. I heard that you eat your steaks well done. With ketchup. I don't know that you can trust someone that eats their steaks well done to do a pulled pork.
I usually do pork shoulder when I smoke my meat. I thought about branching out and doing some beef, but I don't want a brisket.
You gotta risk it for the brisket. Charles better put on a pot of coffee, because Daddy's coming home. No, don't tease that one.
Don't tease that one.
Don't tease that one.
Yes, you.
I thought for a sec, you had more you wanted to say, right?
No.
No.
So, you are not going to want to miss this day. As you can tell, it's going to be a lot of fun. So this is how it's going to work, though. It's going to be directly after church on June 26th, but the person who sells the most tickets, now they each have tickets, their own color tickets. It's going to be whoever gets to you first, basically. So whoever sells the most tickets is going to be crowned the winner. So they both do a big game up here, so let's see how they can take it out to you all. So to get your tickets, after church today, they will be for sale. You can find the dinosaur in the foyer today. Tickets will also be available before and after service on Wednesday night in the gym. You can find me, although this week you're probably going to have to find Lisa Jacob, because I will be at church camp, as will Joe. Might be Charles, I don't know. Oh, Joy will be there. Okay, so pre-sale tickets are $10 each. For walk-ins on the day of, ticket prices are $12 each, so get them ahead of time. All proceeds go to Speed the Light, and Speed the Light is a program that provides much-needed equipment to missionaries across the nation and over 180 countries around the world, so they can spread the gospel and the name of Jesus. So be sure to get your tickets. I'm probably going to have to buy tickets from both, because that's the predicament I'm in right now. But I have leaders on both sides. So find the dinosaur after church. Put in your vote what ticket you want. And, yeah, we will keep promoting it. And there will be Facebook things also. So have a great day.
I don't know how to follow that because that was very amazing. So good morning. My name is Angie Reffo, and I'm so happy to welcome you all today. Just a reminder to sign in. So there is an iPad in the back foyer for you to sign in, or you can download the app to your phone. If you don't know how to do that, Kristen Atkins, who is our kids director, would be happy to help you download that. Also, we just want to encourage you to fill out the prayer cards that are in front of you. And if you have any special prayer needs, our prayer team will pray for you throughout the week. And you can stick those back in the black boxes at the back of the worship center. Also, there's a couple other things going on this week. Like Pastor Sherry said, the youth are going to camp this week from June 13th to the 17th. So make sure you keep them in your prayers as they go and they have safe travels. And then our kids' camp is July 6th through the 9th. Also, on Wednesday nights, if you want to get connected on Wednesdays, we have an adult class that Pastor Jeff leads called Emotionally Healthy Spirituality. It's in room 101. There is still time to sign up. This is the last week to sign up. So if you haven't been going, you can go to that class on Wednesday night. It's from 7 to 8:30. We also have Counterculture Youth in the Gym. And our K through 5th grade is doing a summer program with lots of cool things. They're coming. Please pray for me because in July they're all coming to my house to swim in my pool. So please pray for me because last year it was like tons of kids jumping in. And then we also have our nursery. So if you have any kids that are under kindergarten, we have a nursery for them too. So you guys can, there's no excuse not to go to class. So everybody needs to come on Wednesdays too. And then also on Sunday mornings, like I mentioned last week, we do have prayer in the prayer room at 9:15, so please come to that as well. It was awesome today. There was a lot more people than last week, so we're getting there. But I want to see this whole worship center filled with everybody coming. That is our prayer and our wish. And then today, if you're new and you don't kind of know what happens during service, so Pastor Bill today will be giving our message for about 30 minutes. Then we'll have more praise and worship time, and you are welcome to come up to the altars as you feel called by the Spirit. And we would love to pray for you as well, so you can come up at during that time and have prayer. And I think that's all for today. Have a blessed day, everybody.
How are you? Man, who's ready for some barbecue? Yeah. I am very excited about that, so thank you to you guys. You notice you're sitting at opposite ends of the worship center today. I don't know what's going on here. Like, okay. And he is the champion. Want you to know, he was our champ from our last cook-off, so he carries the plaque. So it's going to be good. Let me just encourage you. Let's be generous. Let's give to Speed the Light, and you're going to get a lunch as a thank you. All right? You're going to be in trouble if you go, well, wait a minute. If I ate 4 ounces of brisket and that cost me 25, and then I get the, don't do that. This is a fundraiser. Amen. Just like you, well, it's just like you guys rock BGMC. We raise more money for those cupcakes and those cakes than we have ever since I've been here in 7 years. And you're like, oh, yeah. Oh, we're just going to be generous and give, and we're going to get a sugar rush out of it. So, yeah. So, same kind of a deal, except you're going to get grease about this area right here. So it's going to be good. So, I want to encourage you with that. I want to talk to you a little bit about giving. From what Jesus taught us about this, you know, somebody asked me the other day, I always love when people challenge, I get a good challenging question. Do you ever get those sometimes? Guy asked me, so Jeff, do you ever doubt that you might be wrong? Well, several things I am wrong. So I'm very comfortable in that, but when it comes to Jesus, I'm not. I'm not. You know why? Because he's demonstrated his reality to me through giving. We never think about this. We never think about this. So let's see what Jesus says about this, okay? So Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 1, he's doing some teaching, and there's two things he's warning people about. But this is what he says. Beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise, you'll have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. So the first thing that he's talking about is giving. So when you give to the poor, don't sound a trumpet before you as hypocrites do in the synagogues or in the streets so that they may be honored by men. Truly, I say to you that they have their reward in full. But now here it is. This is what I want to talk about this morning. But when you give to the poor, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving will be in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret, he will reward you. In the scriptures, there's several types of giving. You know, there's tithing. We, you know, we're encouraged to give 10% of our income to God, you know, or 10% of our produce if you're living in an agrarian society, or, you know, and so that's our tithe. But then there's this whole thing called almsgiving in the scriptures, where we are able to give to needs. In the temple, when you left the temple, they had all these boxes, and in these boxes they had these kind of, I don't know, they look like giant trombones. That's about how I can explain it. But there's these big funnels, okay? And so if you gave in this box, you gave to the building. If you gave in this box, you gave to the poor. If you gave in this box, you gave to the priest. So anyway, they had all these different opportunities. So when people were leaving, remember Jesus was watching one day, and people were pouring all of these coins down these receptacles. And when you pour a lot of coin, you can hear it, right? But that day, a lady dropped in a couple of coins. And he says, hold the fort, everybody. She gave more than everybody, right? And his economy is a little bit different than how this world looks at the economy and those kinds of things. But he said she gave out of her need. She gave it all. She gave, and so the disciples, I'm sure, are like, whoa, we're going to have to talk to him about that later. But one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen, I was in the Dominican Republic doing a setup trip for a missions team that was coming down, and I was having dinner with the people that were hosting us, and, you know, it was, they lived, if you can imagine, you think your neighborhood is noisy, how would you like to live, and right behind you is a metal shop, and they don't have motorized saws, rebar, cutting by hand with hacksaws, starting at 7 in the morning, and not stopping until like 6 at night. Whew. Didn't sleep that much. These people lived there, and they had me over for lunch, and she was making this really beautiful food I've never had before in my life. I'm risky when I eat, whatever. If it doesn't crawl away from me, I'll give it a shot. So here's this beautiful, I mean, she got the nice, now listen, she got the nice plates out, and you know, she was just blessing us, and she made us this beautiful lunch. And then she looked out the window, and she saw this guy walking by. Walking is the operative word. He was hobbling by. And she says, excuse me, people. And so we said, oh, go ahead. So she goes outside, and she finds this guy that has a festering foot sore. He can hardly walk. In fact, his whole foot is swollen, and it's the infection is going up his leg. And so she grabs a chair from the house, sits it down outside, comes over, takes her plate, goes outside, gives him the plate, comes in, gets something to drink for him. And here's this person who has nothing. And as he's having lunch from her best dishes, she's dressing his wound. I'll never forget that. I'll never forget that. That here's a person that is so aware of her surroundings that whenever anybody in need comes by, she's going to meet that need. Lord, make us like that. Amen. One of the most beautiful things about this teaching is that you'll notice that Jesus says, hey, listen, when you do that, and when you live your life that way and nobody sees it, you don't get written a receipt for it. We like receding. It's a different kind of offering. Your Father in heaven sees that, because giving is a partnership. It's the grace of God flowing through you. I taught about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, that when they receive the gift, they look to you and they're so grateful that you're giving. But it is the ministry of the grace of God that flows through you. And it's such a holy thing that it's something, that kind of giving's kind of to be done in private. Don't tell anybody about it. For the person who's receiving it, so that they can be encouraged by that. Amen. We can lift them up. And so I just want to encourage you, church. I'm so grateful. Because we live in the type of facility we have here, we always have opportunities to pay for stuff that breaks. Amen. And we just bought another air handling unit, $9,000. Boom. But where did that come from? Our tithing, because out of our tithing, we set our budgets to refresh all of our HVAC funds and all those things. We're able to do that. We're not able to go, oh, well, we better wait 9 months and see if we can. No. No, we're not going to tell our kids, oh, go ahead and sweat this summer. Sorry, we don't have them. No. Right? Amen. It's because it's the blessing of God. And more than anything as a church, I crave his blessing upon us. So I want to say to you, well done, good and faithful servants. Let's continue, amen? And I pray that God gives you an opportunity for some extracurricular generosity, because the beautiful thing is you just can't outgive him. So if you meet that need, man, he's going to reward you so that you can just be a channel of the grace of God. That's what we're to be. We're not a reservoir. We don't hoard it. We give it away, amen? So, Father, we come to you today, and we thank you that you have blessed us in such a way in so many areas, God. Thank you for all the people that made it possible to fund our scholarship fund this year, sending our kids to camp. Lord, we just rejoice. We rejoice in the missions endeavors that we're able to participate in and to be a part of, oh, God. We're thankful for that, and I'm thankful because I stand in the midst of a congregation that loves you, and they worship you, not just with their lips and their voice and their hearts. Lord, they worship you with their giving, and I thank you for them, and I pray that you return a blessing to them today in Jesus' name. Amen. I am so thrilled that we have Bill Barnes with us today. He is on the preaching team. Thank you, Lisa, who's probably in the nursery this morning. I don't see her. Didn't she do good last week? Woo! Wow, there's starfish all over this city, I am sure. My neighbor goes, yep, I'm putting that starfish in my squad car. So, yeah. So that's pretty awesome. So it was really good. So tell her I said thank you for that. And so we're in our summer preaching series, preaching about passion. So this is our second one. So would you please welcome Bill Barnes as he comes and shares a word with us today. The Holy Ghost.
I walked into the prayer room this morning and saw the shirt he had on. I said, yes, I got the memo. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yes. Mike, tell your wife. Beautiful word last week. Way to set the table for this month that we'll be preaching on passion. So while we're in this series and beyond, I'm sure Pastor Jeff won't mind if you respond to the preaching with an amen. Or I got it, or wow, or you know, when the Holy Spirit speaks to you through the word, it's okay to holler back, if you will, okay? But today I want to bring to you a message about the process of providence and how God positions us and how God even uses our passions. And I want to begin, though, with a question. And the question I pose to you is this, and you don't have to answer it out loud, okay? Some of you, you know, you get a question, you just want to shout out the answer. But here is the question that I start with. What is your greatest passion in life? What is your greatest passion in life? Now, I'm going to give you just a moment to think about that, and then I'm going to answer that question for you, okay? So I'll give you just a couple of seconds. What is your greatest passion in life? A couple of weeks ago, after we had met as a preaching team and I found out exactly what it was I would be speaking about on this day, I posed this very question on my Facebook page. Now, I won't give you in detail every one of the answers I got, but some of the common responses were family. People said they were passionate. Their greatest passion was their family. Some said music was their greatest passion. Others said nature, being outside in the beauty of God's nature, whether that might be hunting or fishing or gardening, the outdoors. Some said brownies. Now, let me explain, okay? Pastor, I think at some point there has to be a brownie bake-off, okay? Because I tell you what, my wife makes some of the best brownies in the world. If you don't believe me, ask everybody that works at the mill over there in Burns Harbor, because I take it to my work. And, well, some of you may have tasted them at last year's tailgate party, okay? So if you missed that, I'm sure she's going to bring it back this year. So keep in mind, okay? And then some also said their greatest passion was Jesus. Now, the truth be told, much of the time, what may appear to be our greatest passion or our greatest passions are merely sub-passions, if you will. Because there is actually one primary or one root passion that drives every one of us. Are you ready for me to tell you what you are most passionate about? Some of you are going, okay, this guy's crazy, okay? Without exception, I truly believe that our greatest passion in life is life itself. Wired within each of us is a deep-seated passion to live. I don't mean just to suck air in. I don't mean just to have our heartbeat. I mean within us, within our hearts, what is driving us is a passion for life. Deep down, we don't truly, we want to merely live. We want to experience life. We don't want just to exist. We want a meaningful life. We don't want to just endure the mundane. We want to thrive. We want to live our lives and have our lives to be more than just dust in the wind. If you grew up in the 70s, you may have heard of a group called Kansas. Okay? And one of their hit songs was a ballad. All we are, the chorus says, is dust in the wind. One of the verses says, same old song, just a drop of water in an endless sea. All we do crumbles to the ground, though we refuse to see. All we are is dust in the wind. I'm sorry, some of you have got that guitar, the acoustic guitar now, in your head, and it'll be there until you leave today. All we are, we want to be more than dust in the wind. Did a little research on that, and they wouldn't confirm whether or not these guys got this song from scripture, but there's a whole lot of scriptural undertone to what they were saying and some of the things there, because the truth is the Bible says dust we are and to dust we shall return, but we don't want to merely live our lives as dust that blows here and there and has no purpose. Well, speaking of returning to the dust we came from, let me just get off track for one moment, if you'll permit me. Perhaps you've heard the poem, Dust If You Must. Have you heard that poem? Let me just read it to you real quick. It's by Rose Milligan. It says, dust if you must, but wouldn't it be better to paint a picture or write a letter? To bake a cake or plant a seed, to ponder the difference between want and need. Dust if you must, but there's not much time with rivers to swim and mountains to climb, with music to hear and books to read, with friends to cherish and a life to lead. Dust if you must, but the world's out there, with the sun in your eyes and the wind in your hair, a flutter of snow and a shower of rain, this day will not come around again. Dust if you must, but bear in mind, old age will come and it's not kind. Can you say an amen? And it's not kind. And when you go, and go you must, you yourself will make more dust. We don't want to be just dust in the wind. Well, as I share this message today on passion and how it works, I want to give you some steps or a part of the process and hopefully paint a picture that will enable us to understand each of those components more clearly. So hopefully you have your notes that were sent to you on your phone and be able to have them on the screen. So I'm going to start by giving you those steps or parts of the process up front. So when you hear these five parts, so relax, okay? I don't have 16 sub-points for each point, okay? When you hear these points, okay, I'm going to explain them a little bit more in detail, but I just want to give them to you all at the beginning. The first is this. God plants within us a passion for life. God plants within us a passion for life. Secondly, none of us on our own initially look to God to fulfill that passion. God plants the passion for life inside us, but initially, none of us go after God to find out how to fulfill this longing inside us. Thirdly, God draws us to himself by allowing us to experience the emptiness of chasing earthly passions without him. He plants the passion. We go looking how to fulfill it somewhere else. God lets us go looking until we get to a place where we understand all the other stuff that we're looking for to find life is so empty and leaves us so empty. But then fourthly, once we recognize that in Christ and Christ alone is found life, the life that we long for, God then positions us in Christ and his life begins to flow through us. Whew, that gives me goosebumps just to think about it. When we understand where life is found, we sang about it today. His name is healing. His name is power. His name is life. When we recognize that in Jesus there is life and we come to him and embrace that truth, his life begins to flow through us. Fifth, once positioned in Christ, God allows us to experience a fullness of life by positioning us to bring him glory. All right, so I'm going to go through each of those. So hopefully I've given you a quick overview, and I'm not going to take a lot of time on each point. But the first, God plants within us a passion for life. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, in the Amplified Version of the Bible says this: he has made everything beautiful and appropriate in its time. He has also planted eternity, a sense of divine purpose in the human heart, a mysterious longing which nothing under the sun can satisfy except God. Come on now. God has planted eternity in our heart. God has planted this longing in our heart for some purpose, and that purpose can only be fulfilled in him. Satan does not give us a passion for life. Jesus described our enemy as a thief that comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Everything that's the opposite of what life is. He comes to steal life. He comes to take life. He comes to destroy life. If anything, what Satan does with our passions is he hijacks them. He distorts them. He encourages us to be dragged away by our passions. James says when we're tempted, what happens is we allow our desires, not always even evil desires, we allow our desires to pull us away and to become evil because we place them in front of God. What Jesus said, Satan is that thief who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He would go on to say, but I have come that you might have life and have it to the full. Are we on? I said, Jesus said, I have come that we might have life and have it to the full. So I hope you understand with this first point, I hope it's clear that a passion for life is not a sin. If you're passionate about life, it's not a sin. It's actually a part of God's design and plan for us. And the reason is this, is because it's that passion that eventually and hopefully leads us right back to the Creator. My second point, none of us on our own initially look to God to fulfill this passion for life. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6 says this. It says, we all. Say the word all with me. All. Look at somebody else and say all. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. We all, it says, like sheep. Now, that's interesting. Have you ever stopped to think about that? Why is it that sheep go astray? Huh? Why is that? They need a shepherd. But they do need a shepherd, but why do they stray? The reason, without oversimplifying it, it's this. They stray because they have a passion to satisfy a hunger, but they never lift their head up. They never look up. They don't know where the shepherd's at because they're too busy looking down, following after that which is going to fulfill the next longing for just a moment in time. What an accurate picture of who we are without Christ. Walking around with our head down, never looking up, never looking up to the one who created us. Just looking for that next meal, if you will, that next thing that hopefully will fill that longing inside of us. Paul would say the same thing in Romans chapter 3 in the New Testament. In verse 11, he said, there is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. Now, let me just say this here. Some people turn away from God, and yet they passionately do some really good things with their life. Others just as passionately turn away from God, and they do some very bad things. But listen to me. Both the rebel and the do-gooder often are pursuing the same thing, and that's life. The rebel believes life is found in a life that is lived without boundaries. But the person who does good believes that life is found in being a blessing and helping and giving. One says live life for me, another says live life for others, and they're both searching for the same thing. They're looking for life. So please understand, God plants the passion for life, but initially none of us look to him to fulfill that passion. Thirdly, God draws us to himself by allowing us to experience the emptiness of pursuing passion without him. As an example, I want to talk to you for just a moment about Solomon. I want to share some words of Solomon's found in Ecclesiastes. Start with Ecclesiastes chapter 1 and verse 1. And if you read, and I'm going to read the first two verses, if you started to read Ecclesiastes, you might not have made it past the first couple of verses and go, man, this is a downer. But he starts out with a summary of his findings. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 1 says, the words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. And I was going to open my sermon with that scripture text, but I thought some of you would have checked out right away. You're like, oh, I ain't listening to this. But again, this was his conclusion, okay? It's like, you know, watching a movie and they show you something and they back you up a few years to see how they got there, okay? He concluded this after he pursued every passion imaginable in search of a meaningful life. Chapter 2, verse 10 of Ecclesiastes said this. Solomon said, I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. He said, I went after it all. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my labor, and this was the reward I got from my toil. He said, I felt proud of what I'd done, and yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. Now, I don't have the time, and nor will I take the time to read all the verses that I could read from the first three chapters of Ecclesiastes. So I'm going to give you a challenge. You don't have to go home and do it today, but I'm going to challenge you this week to sit down and open up the book of Ecclesiastes and read the first few chapters and see for yourself if Solomon's passion for life did not take him down every possible path. He exhausted every path possible looking for life. In fact, I'll summarize the places he looked. He looked for life in wisdom. He looked for life in wine. He looked for life in women. He looked for life in wildness. That just means no boundaries. He looked for life in wealth. He looked for life in work. Now, if you find another passion when you read it, just make sure it has a W, okay? Because it's got to stay. No, I'm just kidding. He thought he had the winning combination, but he ended up feeling like a loser. Because none of these things delivered as promised, none of them delivered as he had hoped for. Now, I'm not going to ask you today if you have ever chased the wind. But I wonder, have you ever, raise your hand, if you've ever chased something that the wind has blown away from you. Raise your hand. Look around, okay? If you dropped a dollar bill, okay? Used to be, oh man, I dropped a dollar bill. That's a quarter of a tank of gas, man. You can't even get the nozzle turned on today for a dollar. Be like, I got to get that dollar. Or a receipt. Or if I'm getting out of my car and I don't have my lid on securely, I don't want to litter and the wind blows the lid. I want to go get it. A few years ago at the church I pastored in Michigan City, for some reason, I don't know what we were doing, but we had a bunch of styrofoam, big pieces of blue styrofoam, not the little peanut things, but I had to throw them away, and the dumpster was across our church parking lot. So being a man, I only want to make one trip. So I put as much styrofoam as I can in a box, and I wrap my arms around it, so I'm going to get it to the dumpster and don't have to go back again, and I am fighting the wind all the way across. And wouldn't you know it, when I got to the dumpster, the lid wasn't open. So I had to set the box down in order to open the lid to put the styrofoam into the dumpster. And when I did, the wind blew the styrofoam across the parking lot. Okay, again, being a man. Okay, again, I'm not insulting you, man. But I'm not going to run after it. I'm not going to look foolish. I'm just going to walk fast. You know what I'm saying? I'm just going to try to act normal and catch the styrofoam. And just about the time that I'd get to a piece of styrofoam to put my foot on it, another gust of wind would blow it further from me. I looked up as if to say, God, are you serious? And in that moment in time, it was as if the Holy Spirit said, do you remember who the prince of the power of the air is? Don't blame God. But you know that feeling. You know that feeling when you're after something that's blown by the wind, that elusiveness of trying to grab it. And that's what Solomon was saying. He was looking for life in so many things, and it was just like they were just blown through the wind. So this is what he said in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 17. So I hated life. The richest man in the world. Okay, let me talk to you secularly right now for just a second. The man who had any woman he wanted. The man who could party, who could build. He had everything. So I hated life because the work that is done under the sun was grievous to me. All of it is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Verse 18, I hated all the things I had toiled for under the sun. And verse 20 says, so my heart began to despair over all my toilsome labor under the sun. Before we will look to God for life, we must first become convinced in our hearts that we're not going to find it somewhere else. Let me say that again. We turned away from God in the beginning, looking for life somewhere else. Before we will turn to God, we have to become convinced in our heart that it's there and there alone that we're going to find life. We have to become, and that's why God allows us to experience the emptiness of life without him. I heard a sermon one time, I think it was Andy Stanley, preached about Ecclesiastes. And he said the key to understanding what Solomon was saying there in Ecclesiastes was that phrase, under the sun, S-U-N. He was looking for meaning in such a limited perspective. Under the sun. We need to look for meaning under the sun, S-O-N, not S-U-N. But we have to become convinced in our hearts that we're not going to find it somewhere else. I've done it. I'm sure you've had other pastors do it. Maybe you've done it. Maybe you've tried to convince somebody to come to Jesus so they could go to heaven when they die. Eternal life is not a destination, it's a person. It's Jesus. John 17, Jesus talked about the fact that he is life, and knowing him and the Father, that's what eternal life really is. When the parable of the prodigal son in Luke 15, God is represented by the Father who allows his son the freedom to choose to walk away from him and experience what he thought would be real life. The younger son comes and says, Dad, I want my share of the inheritance. Basically, he said, to me, you're as good as dead, because that's how you got an inheritance, when they died. And so in his words, he was saying, Dad, you're dead to me. You're as good as dead. Give me my share of the inheritance. And he went off and he wasted it in wild living. And once he wasted all of his money in wild living, wasted every bit of the wealth, and once he himself began to waste away because there was a famine in the land and there was no food, he longed to eat what the pigs were eating. Nobody would give him anything. The Bible says he finally came to his senses. And what he realized was this. Man, it's good at my Father's house. It's good at my Father's house, even for the servants at my Father's house. Why did his father let him go? Why didn't his father make him stay? Why did his father let him go through that experience? Why? Because when he came back, here's what his father said to him when they began to celebrate. He said, this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He could have forced him to stay and said, no, I'm not giving you a dime until I die. You're not going to see a penny of my money until I kick the bucket. No, he said, you think that life is found out there? You go searching for life, and you know what? I'll be here with open arms ready to welcome you back when you realize that life is found at home. What an irony. The son thought that he could find life by leaving home, but the truth was he didn't even begin to leave till he came back home. On resurrection morning, the women showed up at the tomb. They're going to anoint the body of Jesus, and the angels startled them and asked them a question. Why do you look for the living among the dead? And you know, this is exactly what we do when we look for life apart from Christ. When we look to dead or lifeless things to bring us life rather than to look to the very source of life. Fourth point. I'm moving quickly. I'm going to get in that 30 minutes, hopefully. Once we realize and believe and embrace the truth that in Christ alone we find life, God then positions us in Christ where his life flows through us. Ephesians 1:13, Paul said this, and you also were included in Christ. You were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. So we're positioned, we're placed in Christ when we come to believe that he is the source of life. John says it this way in 1 John 5:12. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. Now, I'm no rocket scientist, but that I can understand that. If you've got Jesus, you have life. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have life. You can be the world's greatest philanthropist, generously giving your time, your effort, your money to help others, but if you don't have the Son, you don't have life. So it's in Jesus alone that life is found. And lastly, once positioned in Christ, God allows us to experience the fullness of life by positioning us to bring him glory. All right. I didn't put this statement in your notes, but I probably should have. Listen to this. We are never more fully alive than when we are doing what we were created to do, which is to bring glory to God. We're never more fully alive than when we're doing what we were created to do, which is to bring glory to God. Let me illustrate it this way. Imagine for a moment Steph Curry as a businessman. Sitting in an office behind a computer all day. If I imagine that, I know what he'd be doing. He'd be wasting all the computer paper shooting baskets. That's what he would be doing. All right? Imagine him as a businessman rather than being one of the best shooters in NBA history. When it comes time for him to retire, I would imagine it's not going to be easy for him to retire. He might have a couple retirements. I'm coming back out of retirement. Why? Because it sure seems that he was born to play basketball. It sure seems that way. And when he steps out on the court, it's like, man, the game comes to life. Now let's translate that to the spiritual. Because God knows that we come to life when we bring him glory. He will position us with opportunities to do that very thing. And many times he will use our own passions and our own desires. Simple example. I have an appetite that likes Wendy's. I like Wendy's $5 biggie bag even more these days. All right? And it used to be that I'd go to Wendy's a couple times a week. I'd just go there for lunch by myself often there in Michigan City. I'd catch up on some email, do some responding, eat my lunch, and just enjoy that time. But there was one occasion where I'd been there, I think, two times already that week, and I sensed this desire for Wendy's. In fact, I think I'd gone there the day before. I'm like, I kept trying to convince myself to want Taco Bell or something else. But there was something drawing me back to Wendy's again. And please understand, it's not the food. This is not a commercial for Wendy's, if you know. But when I got there, I sat down, and there was a man that I knew, and he sat and just began to open up. Open up about fear of death. Began to open up about even taking his own life. He sat there, and in time, I realized why I was there. I wasn't there for myself. I was there for his glory and for this man. But God drew me there by an appetite. God sent me there. He positioned me there, even by a passion of mine, which was chicken nuggets and Frosties. You don't recognize the name Joshua Baltzel, unless, of course, you've been around Michigan City. But he didn't go to the church that I pastored. He went to another church in time, but his passion is basketball. I got a passion for basketball, but my body just doesn't respond anymore. But this man gets out there and plays with the young men. We met one time at a community men's breakfast. He happened to sit at my table. I say he happened to sit at my table. He found out that our church, we had a gym. And he said, man, I would love to be able to bring the guys in off the streets, play ball, and share Jesus with them. And I said, I'd love for you to do that. You don't go to my church, I'll open up the gym. You come on in, you play ball, you share Jesus. He called this basketball ministry Crossover. Now, if you don't follow basketball, you don't understand that word crossover. But if you follow basketball, crossover is an important word. And you know what? It wasn't just a crossover on the court. He was making a crossover in life. And he had young men that came to accept Jesus because he got out there and played basketball with them. And they got to baptize them in water. He had a passion for basketball. And God says, you know what? I'm going to position you in a place where you can fulfill that passion and bring me glory in the meantime. Now, let me be real clear. Not every position that God puts us in for the sake of his glory is always pleasant. It's not always fries and Frosties or ball games. Sometimes there's pain. Joseph was a man that God positioned to save many lives during a severe famine. But to get to that position in the palace, he first of all had to go through a pit where his brother sold him into slavery. He had to be thrown into prison because Potiphar's wife, scorned woman, lied and said he accused him of rape when he didn't. And then he was sent to prison, and somebody whose dream he interpreted completely forgot about him, and he's left there 2 more years. But you know what? He never became a bitter man. And eventually God positioned that place in the palace where he could be and save many lives. In the New Testament, the apostles were beaten by the Sanhedrin for preaching the name of Jesus. When it's done, do they stop? No, it says they went away rejoicing. Why? Because they counted themselves worthy of suffering for his name. How in the world could you rejoice after a beating? Why? Because they knew that what they had just done was bring glory to God, and they were more alive after that beating than they had been before. In 1 Timothy 6, Paul instructed the believers to be rich in good deeds and to bring glory to God. He commanded them, look at the scripture, 1 Timothy 6:18, to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age. And here's the key part, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. If there's a life that is truly life to take hold of, then there's a life that's not truly life. A lot of times people think, you know what? You know what I really need to live? I need more money. I need more money. I need more. If only I had more, a bigger house, a bigger bank account, if only I had a bigger, better car, if only I had more. That's what brought one brother to Jesus and said, Master, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me. And Jesus says, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. It doesn't consist in the abundance of his possessions. If you're a follower of Christ and you're not experiencing the fullness of life, it could be that even though God positions you to bring him glory, you're living for your own glory rather than his. Take hold of the life that is truly life by choosing to make God his glory, your passion. Whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Psalm 90, verse 10 says, our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. Verse 12 says, teach us to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. What is Moses saying in these verses? He's saying life is short, it passes quickly. God, teach us to make each day count. Pastor Jeff, can you come up here? Is Pastor Mike back there too? All right, come on up here too. Can you take this tape? I'm going to give you one side of this tape measure. Pastor Jeff, if you'll take it out to 80 inches. 70 years are given to us, or 80, Psalms 90 says. Now, that's not a guarantee. An approximate lifespan. Right now, I am just barely hanging beneath 60. I know you're shocked. You thought I was probably further down this scale. But I'm just clinging to 59. Which, if I live till I'm 80, that means this is how much time I have left to truly live and bring glory to God. What I've done from this side on is the past. I can't do anything about that, but I still, as long as I have breath, I still have opportunity to passionately even live out my passions to bring him glory. Pastor Jeff, take it down to 70. Visually, Lisa said she's a visual. I'm visual too. If it's 70, you notice I have a lot less. Take it down to 62 if you would. My father passed when he was 62. If I don't live longer than my father, I pray that I do, and it's in God's hands. But that's all the time I really have left to live for his glory. Thank you, guys. Some of you are thinking, man, I'm older than 80. Well, you know what? God's giving you some extra time. Choose to use every moment. But my point is this. He planted this passion for life in you. He's the only one that can fulfill it. When you come to him, don't come to him just for you know, life in heaven when you die. Come to him to enjoy life to the fullest now. And when you do that by bringing him glory. You can do that on the ball court. You can do that in the workplace. You can do that in the restaurant. You can bring him glory wherever you are. All of the passions we have, the passions that God has placed in us, can be used for his glory. Stit nam tigag. Stit nam tigag. You know what that is? I'm not speaking in tongues. Lisa would know right away. See to it that no one misses the grace of God. How do we possibly see to it that nobody misses the grace of God? By allowing others to see. That first word is S-E-E. See to it, allowing others to see us full of life and reflectors of his glory. That's where they see the grace of God. Now forgive me, I don't mean to offend you if this is you in any way, but perhaps you know somebody who likes to dress loud. You know what I mean when I say dress loud? To dress loud is to dress in bold colors or bold patterns. Well, guess what? The person who dresses loud, when they walk into a room, you can't miss them. You can't miss them. And so what I'm saying to you today, church, is this. May we dress loudly, full of grace and full of his glory, so that we walk into a room, people can't miss the life of God. They see it all over us. Something else Lisa said, and then I'll stop. She reminded us through the scripture last week that Abel still speaks, though he is dead. And I thought about it this week. I don't believe there's a single verse in Scripture that has Abel speaking a word. I know he could speak, but we don't have any recorded words. But yet his life, it says he still speaks though he is dead. How does he speak? Not by his words, but rather the life that he lived, a life of faith in God. I pray that God would see in you, that people would see in you, that people would see in me the life of God. Not just a confession that we're a believer and that we're going to heaven, but that we have the life of Jesus in us now and we are full of life. Praise God. Let us worship. Would you stand right now as the worship team comes? One of the reasons I think that so many of us love worship time so much, not just that it makes us feel good. You know, there was a song that came out some years back, I'm coming back to the heart of worship and it's all about you. And it's almost like, you know, you started to feel bad if you felt good about worship. Like, okay, worship's not for me, it's for God. But you know the reason we start to feel good? Because we come alive when we worship because we're bringing him glory. So we start to feel, we feel the life rise up because this is one of the ways that we bring glory to God by giving him the glory and honor that he deserves.
Gospel, truth, the Lord shall not kneel, shall not.
If you didn't get your communion packets, go ahead and make movement. You'll be able to hear me no matter where you're at in the room, so you'll be okay. First of all, thank you, bro, for the first time I've heard you, and you did not disappoint. People get up here, and when they get on this platform and speak about what God is saying, has spoken to them, you have to understand that he said to do it as the very, basically, I'm speaking what God wants to be said here. And I mean, raise your hand if you felt like God spoke to you this morning. Well, I'm confident right now because we didn't talk before he gave this message. I knew what his message was going to be about, but I didn't know the full extent, how he was going to approach it. And the reason I'm confident right now is because I'm just going to share two scriptures with you. I'm not going to make this long because it really goes really along the same line of what you spoke. So I don't really have a whole lot to say. But when we take this bread in this cup, it represents something. It represents the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And Paul said, hey, when you take this, don't take this not recognizing that. Recognize that. I'm going to share this scripture. He's on the day when he's about to be taken. He just got finished washing their feet in John chapter 14. He spoke to his disciples and he said, look, in John chapter 14, starting in verse 9, have I been with you so long and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father, so how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the work. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father, and whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. He said that he's going to answer those prayers so that he would be glorified. This brings glory to God. So you're like, man, does God care about what I pray? Yes, he cares about what you're praying. Because it brings glory to the Father. You should have passion about prayer. Because you know he wants your prayers answered because it brings glory to the Father. When we take this I want you to consider something. In Psalm chapter 17, I don't see Tanaja right now, but I got the scripture from her. We were texting. You are what you eat. From your head down to your feet. I know that's not scripture, but you've heard it a lot. You know that what you eat, right? That becomes what your physical body is, right? So when we take this body, he just got finished showing us inside that scripture that he's in the Father and the Father's in him. And now we're coming into that process. If we went further into 17, he said, I can't wait until you all become one as I and the Father are one. And then we'll come to you and you'll be one with us. When you take this body, this is hope. And also, it's a really small piece of bread, right? That's why we come back again and again and again. You weren't meant to be satisfied one time. You do this over and over because guess what? Being human, sometimes God got to tell me over and over and over. So never get tired of this. Never get where this gets old. Because Jesus is telling you as you take this that he's doing something inside of you. And in Psalm chapter 17, verse 15, he says, as for me, this is David talking, I will see your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awaken your likeness. Jesus is bringing you into his likeness, not someday, some way, somewhere, or far, but from glory to glory. Say it with me. To glory, to glory, to glory, to glory. Take this bread, believing him that he's changing you into his very image. We are the body of Christ for a reason. The head don't pick up nothing. The head don't walk you anywhere. He tells the feet to move, so we gotta move. We are the body. He's forming us into that image. Please take the bread with me. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for what you did on that cross, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God, that you saw all my mistakes and my shortcomings, and you saw everything that we would do that did not line up with what you wanted us to do, and you did it anyway. Now, as we take this blood, I know it sounds, when I say that, I sound, man, a lot of people have a struggle with communion because they're like, man, this stuff sounds kind of gory. Y'all talking body and blood. No, I didn't get no physical bliss. It's some kind of grape juice. If somebody doesn't know, doesn't understand, it's whatever juice it is. But it says we walk by faith and not by sight. For us who believe, we're partaking of that death. For us who believe, by his stripes we are healed. If you need healing, please don't leave out of here today without praying with somebody, because I see a whole lot of people that are well qualified to pray for healing for you. So this same blood, it said, by his stripes we are healed. But also, this same blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. So if I had a bad night, guess what? It said it washes me white as snow. Don't walk out of here with a conscience. Please don't walk out of here with some kind of conscience when you get finished drinking this. Believe Jesus that it'll make you white as snow. Let's get a fresh start. Let's walk out the door with your chest out, with your chin up. I have a future, a purpose, and a destiny because of what he did for me. When you drink this, do this by faith. You're clean. You are clean. Thank you, Jesus, that you made us clean. I will not be satisfied until I end up in your image, in your likeness. Let's take the cup.
This is a good place within this service this morning. If you need healing, if you need prayer for healing, please come up. I'm going to have our prayer team come up, our deacons, elders, whoever is here. As we sing this next song, just make your way.
when I walk through deep waters, I know that you will be with me. When I'm standing in the fire, I will not be overcome.
could get used to this. And if this is a glimpse of heaven, I could get used to this. I could get used to this. And the fragrance of your presence, I could get used to this. I could get used to this.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for another week of preaching on passion, Father God, and for giving us life and a passion for life, Lord God. Help us to live our lives with purpose and not just merely blowing around like the dust, Father God, but help us not to chase things that are not of you. Help us to look to you first, Father, for fulfilling our passions, Lord, and not on our own doing, Lord God. I pray, Lord, that you continue to flow through us this week and you give us longing for you like we've never had before, Lord God. Keep the evil one far from us so that our focus is strictly on you in it, with all that we do. I pray, Lord, right now that you would never let us stray far from you, Lord God, and that you would continue ordering our every step. Help us to use the passion and the gifts, Lord God, that you had given us to be a blessing to others and for your kingdom. And Lord God, as we go through this week, Lord Jesus, I just pray, Lord God, that our focus would be only on you, Jesus, not the circumstances that are around us, not what doctors say, because you, Father God, are the doctor, Lord God. You are the final say in it all. And Lord Jesus, right now, Father God, I cover each one that was up here for prayer this morning, Lord Jesus, that you would help them focus only on you, Father God, knowing that you are in complete control of every situation. Help us to be a blessing to those around us this week, Lord God, I pray. And may the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through those storms. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. And may he bring you home rejoicing again into our doors. Thank you guys for being here this morning. Thank you for worshiping the one and only King. We love you and have a great week. You're dismissed.